Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to the broadcast. I'm Breaky CPK, and you're tuning into the Star Ladder I-League Star Series American Qualifiers. Digital Chaos taking on Team Onyx here in a best of two. Our first match, best of twos, going to be coming at you today once again, and really looking forward on continuing on the action. Hopefully you guys are excited to be here as well. I know I am, and I know my co-caster for today is as well. Going to be joined by Minnie here. Minnie, how's it going, man?
Hey, Breaky. Yeah, I'm doing really good. I'm thoroughly excited for this game, actually. Two kind of top
Keeper
teams.
Of the
Obviously,
light.
There's a little bit of a question mark over Team Onyx, but I guess with this game
dire
today,
team
we'll
pick.
Have some bit more information about how good and how valuable they actually are as a team.
Yeah, now obviously, Team Onyx, they're definitely a hot topic team because they're one of these, as I kind of call them, a pug team of sorts. I know that might be not the best term to use, but it's obviously, you know, a bunch of solid all-star style players, even obviously big name players that are kind of coming together, forming this team. You know, obviously most noticeably Wanted, another team with Peter Van Damme and Chessy also doing the same thing. So kind of forming a team together, really making the American region that much stronger and trying to qualify for some of these events. Now, obviously this one specifically, it's a pretty tough event. Only one spot up for grabs. And you have teams like Digital Chaos, Team NP, Complexity even, that are going to be contesting for that. So it's not going to be an easy road by any means. But Team Onyx, so far, they're 1-2-0. They haven't actually gone 0-2 in a series yet, so that is some positive. But no doubt DC the favorite here. And I'm sure the expected ones to come out on top, but we'll see. We'll see how it works out. But Minnie, we got a draft already underway, and so some stuff to talk about. Rubick Juggernaut Bands from Onyx, and we got Lone Druid Ember Spirit taken away from DC. Then we have a Caudal Magmus as well, followed by a Shadow Demon Clockwork. So actually a pretty interesting draft here so far.
Definitely. Yeah, but it's all kind of quite methodical, really. I think it all goes back to the Rubick Dire first ban actually from Team Onyx. So Team Onyx won the coin flip, and they chose first pick. Then they ban out Rubick, which is the biggest and most important ban of that first banning phase. The reason being is because as Team Onyx have the first pick, I think SD as a hero is a very highly contested hero in general. And normally the best way to counter him is if they first pick it, is you pick up Rubick and Luna.
Ten
so you can sort of take
remaining.
Disruption, steal it as a Rubick. And then obviously you can use it alongside your own with your Luna. But obviously with Rubick being banned out, the first pick here from SD makes, with Team Onyx, it makes a lot of sense actually. But obviously there's a lot more heroes going from that as well. But SD being the most really highly contested pick in this draft already.
Yeah, SD has been still one of the most contested, as you're kind of pointing out right there, and more. I mean, it's kind of ridiculous how he has been nerfed
remaining.
Several times, and even with the illusion nerfs of patch 7.0, people were kind of figuring
remaining.
Perhaps that, all right, finally the Shadow Demon, this idea of the illusion meta would maybe die out somewhat. At least for now, that's not the case. I mean, Shadow Demon himself still a very strong support. Obviously now you just build more on the Soul Catcher, if anything, as well as using that
exactly.
Disruption. And then, yeah, Luna, Terrorblade, there's all these heroes that are still very valuable to have with them. So, not surprised to see him picked up here. But I'm more intrigued about DC side. Caudal and Magnus, these are two also not popular picks.
I think the reason why they pick up Caudal and Magnus in the first two is that I think they assumed Team Onyx were going to pick up the Luna after they picked up the SD.
Remaining.
Obviously, Onyx had the first pick, and then DC have to follow up with next two.
5 seconds
Caudal and Magnus
remaining.
Both deal very well against sort of SD Luna. Obviously, the Caudal was very good with the Illuminate, but Magnus has great team
Reserve
fight obviously, with the RP, and obviously with Rubick being banned out as well, it makes even more sense for Magnus being picked up here.
Yeah.
In the first two.
Yeah. So we got the third pick now for DC. We'll see how they follow up the Magnus and the Caudal, but Magnus really is kind of an intriguing hero to me. We actually saw it once yesterday. I think Moomiander. Yeah, that's right. Moomiander played it yesterday against Complexity. He had a huge RP against them, as you would expect to have with a Magnus player. He also built somewhat combat style, and with the new talent tree especially, you could really buff up your damage on the hero. I think it's like an attack speed, a plus damage ability, things like that, and you can actually hit really hard yourself as well as getting that big RP off. So I'm kind of expecting the same thing here from Magnus.
Yeah, well, I mean, Magnus could still be played in the mid lane as well. It's something that, if I think I go back originally, like Dendi from Na'Vi was playing it a lot. You can pick up the Echo Saber, that double hit, kind of like, as you said, with the talent trees as well, like there's a lot more ways to build Magnus than just purely about his RP. You know, obviously the empower is incredibly good as well, and I expect to sort of see a carry here from DC that can really benefit from it. Obviously Juggernaut is banned out. That would have been probably the most likely hero to be paired up with the Magnus, but there's other heroes as well. Slark's still a possibility. Slark decent against SD as well as Leshrac, and okay against Clockwork in the lane. It's definitely a possibility that DC are probably eyeing up in this draft.
Yeah, Slark obviously a popular core hero, but Leshrac, he's kind of in an interesting road. The American team seems like they've been more and more comfortable with him. I know Digital Chaos has used him. Obviously Complexity is pretty notorious from using him, and in fact against DC yesterday, we saw Complexity use him and actually in their victory as they ended in the 1-1 split. But it's going to be Onyx's turn right here, so we'll see how they manage to do with the pick. But
yeah, it's a great pick here as well. Like it's kind of a combination with SD. Obviously, Murano was banned out. They needed a kind of a support hero that can kind of gank quite well with SD. Another hero that some teams use, particularly the Chinese team, is SD plus Sand King. But they chose Leshrac, as you said, because of the pushing power, which they were kind of lacking from their first two. So, yeah, Leshrac, a decent pick here. One hero I want to mention as well before, if it does come out, is Anti-Mage, actually. A hero that hasn't been played barely at all. But it's not going to be picked up here with the Trouble Warlord, which very, very peculiar. I think the biggest reason why they picked up here is to kind of deal with the Clockwork in lane. A lot of melees struggle against Clockwork 1v1 because of the power cogs, obviously. But with Troll Warlord having that range attack, can still benefit from the power, obviously, because you can change to melee form, but it's ranged in the lane phase to deal with the Clockwork. So definitely out of the ball pick, but I can definitely see its merits in this draft.
That is out of left field, man. Yeah, Troll Warlord is not a popular pickup at all. But, again, I don't know if DC specifically has run it before many times or if this is just kind of a unique pickup from them. In fact, I do have
10 seconds remaining.
I do have my Dota buff open right now. I'm going to check real quickly. Yeah, he has not been played yet in this tournament at all. So this is the first appearance for him.
Yeah, I think that's the two main reasons. Five so, obviously, he's still a hero that can benefit from him in power, obviously, when he goes melee form, but it has a ranged ability, or ranged in itself, obviously, when he lanes against the Clockwork, which can cause quite a lot of problems. But they pick up Invoker here for Team Onyx. So we still don't really know whether this Magnus is being played in the mid lane or off lane. I think that's still something that DC are questioning themselves. They're going to have the last pick here in the draft, seeing as Team Onyx had first pick. So DC can kind of figure out what Team Onyx are going to do with their carry pick, and then DC can kind of counter with their mid.
Couple things right here I want to bring up. Invoker pickup, you mentioned for Onyx. Flea actually played Invoker against Complexity, a cast of that series a couple of days ago. Flea's a stand-in for Abed currently, yeah, Albed. He played fantastic. He was a really good Invoker that game, and so I'm looking forward to seeing how he does this game as well. But the other thing, I'm also looking at DC's lineup. Man, they got a lot of buff. You know, you got the Empower, you got the Bloodlust from Ogre Magi, and obviously Coddle can assist with things like the recall here. Yeah. So it's kind of buffing around this Troll Warlord, and I'm curious if they're going to kind of continue that theme with this final pick or not.
Yeah, like I said, I think depending on what the carry here is for Team Onyx, it's going to decide whether Magnus is going to be played in the offlane or mid lane. Like, it's kind of a hard game for an offlane Magnus, though. SD Leshrac is going to really kind of put a lot of pressure on him on the offlane. He's probably going to be forced to go jungle, which Magnus definitely can, obviously, because he can sort of spec in power, even build like an early Iron Talon. But at the same time, it's sometimes you don't want to be playing too passive as a role of an offlane, because that allows the supports to roam mid.
Yeah.
So it depends what DC want to do here. And Moomiander himself always talks about, you know, Iron Talon is a big kind of, more of a hater than a believer, but, you know, definitely understands its merits. So
yeah, Moomiander has some strong opinions on Twitter lately.
Yeah, particularly about Iron Talon. Well, that was a bit like 6 months ago, but still, I think
recently it's about Lone Druid, actually. You know, he's kind of the hot hero right now. Hey, there's
DC's
a Slark pick you're kind of getting at there. Team Onyx, they are going to run the Slark in the end, so we'll see how that works for them.
So right now, I don't think they have the greatest ways to deal with Slark. Like, obviously, Magnus is decent. Troll Warlord isn't the greatest, obviously. They need some more AoE lockdown. Sand King's still on the board. Then Magnus could be played mid. That is a possibility that they could do. Sand King decent against Slark in lane, particularly if he's like 1v1. But they pick up Queen instead, so it is going to be an offlane Magnus. And then have a better matchup against the Invoker mid with Quap. So
Quap. Yeah, I feel like we haven't seen a lot of Quap. This is my third day of casting out the American region, at least for these qualifiers. I haven't seen a lot of Quap, despite the talking up of Quap lately, you know, level 25. Is it maybe that she really, like, obviously she's useful throughout the whole game, but her PowerPoint is really that level 25, the blade mill, the lifesteal and everything. Is it maybe it's kind of a little harder to get there than people make it seem? Or?
Yeah, I think the biggest thing with Quap, like, is that she's always kind of been, like, okay. She's been always, like, decent sort of, you know, in the laning phase especially, and then in the mid-game, and then she does kind of fall off particularly hard. I don't know. I think the reason why she's not been picked up that much recently is that I think there's just been better mids, simply. Like, yes, her 25 is very, very good, but that doesn't necessarily mean why she's not picked, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, it's not like, oh, you have to get 25, and then she's really good. Like, she's still good at the, you know, throughout the stage of the game. The talents just make her even better now in the late game, but I think there's just other heroes that are kind of simply better, or, you know, more heavily picked. Obviously, you know, with the in sort of in more integration of heroes like Sniper, obviously, and heroes like, such as that, that are just a bit more prioritized in the laning phase and in the draft itself. But it's definitely a decent pick here, particularly they needed it and more ways to deal with the Slark, and obviously Quap has decent AoE to deal with it. So, yeah, a decent pick up and a decent matchup against Invoker as well. So.
All right, looks like he's back. Clockwork, that is, and we're good to go. Resume on with game number one. We're getting things kicked off for the day, guys. Our first of three best of twos coming at you. So we're looking forward. I'm Bricky CBK, joined by Mini once again as my co-caster. So here we go. The TPs have begun, and as well as the smokes, of course, looking to get down those wards ASAP. Ooh, Misery just squirting around right here. He is going to get the ward down.
Yeah.
Going to be exposed. Demon, we'll see if he picks up on that.
Misery luckily saw SD. His smoke has been popped, so he knows that they might even. Oh, they should spot that. Yeah, they spotted it. Yeah, that's gonna be an instant ward. So, yeah, and I think that all goes back honestly to DC smoking and Onyx not smoking. So that's a massive advantage, honestly. Obviously now we've, like, we talked about how Moon was gonna have quite a difficult time in the laning phase against the SD Leshrac, but with that D ward there, now Moon's able to farm these two jungle camps a lot more in safety because of it. So that early smoke from DC compared to the lack of smoke from Onyx was a big advantage there in the early game.
Yeah, no, it's simple things like that. You know, it's kind of funny to say, but exactly, it makes a difference. And you know, a lot of people, they have their tiers of teams, and which I've kind of found like a little silly sometimes when people talk about these tiers, because it's like, yeah, obviously you got a team like DC, they're tier one, I guess, they're the top tier. But then how do you classify other teams like Ana for like 1.5 or 2 or 3? It's like, okay, well, who's actually
it's
making these lists?
Like, anyone could be anyone, but obviously there is, you know, higher percentages of in terms of these. Yeah. Another thing I want to mention as well is that because obviously Misery did smoke there, his ward obviously was uncounted, and not only that, but because they realized Ogre was around, they thought he put the ward mid, and so they wasted both their sentries Onyx on the mid lane, so now they do not have a chance. But there is an early smoke though, so they're looking to try and set something up with this disruption plus Leshrac combination.
Yeah, we'll see if they can make a play out of it. But yeah, very good start here for TC when it comes just simply with the vision game. Flea is going to get some delivery there as far as some regen, but Misery going to throw out that ignite and let the harassment begin onto Invoker. So Flea gonna have a difficult time here. You mentioned Quap also happens to do pretty well against Invoker herself. You got an Ogre Magi thrown in there. That's definitely gonna be a difficult task for him. They have given up the top lane though.
Yeah, that smoke rotation though from Onyx just failed. They smoked obviously with the SD and Leshrac. They were looking for Magnus, but I mean, Moon Meander, we talked about what he was going to do. Against SD Leshrac, you were not going to go in that lane. He starts straight away in the jungle, specs in power, and SD and Leshrac, they've just wasted the first minute, and their first smoke gank has failed, while Ogre has been sort of sitting mid and helping Quap. So again, DC already taking a big advantage in this game already.
Bottom lane, you got Love Yourself here on the clockwork. He's gonna run away as Misery coming on over, and Soxa assisting with some auto attacks. I don't think they're gonna get a kill here, but yeah, he's gonna take a lot of damage in the meantime, forced to use that regen. But Moon Meander using that Empower as mentioned, doing a little bit of jungling, and he's even gonna pop a shrine here earlier on to get that life and mana back up and continue doing his job right there with that Iron Talon as mentioned, the item he loves so much there in that jungle area.
Yeah. And it looks like the supports from Onyx now are going to try and get a level 2 again before they rotate. They don't have a smoke on them, so it's going to be hard for them to try and find a kill, particularly because Magnus is playing so defensive. But they are going to come up, try and disrupt Moon, but he looks like he's going to be finished before they can rotate. He's going to go for the bounty though, this might kill him.
Nope. Yep. Disruption comes out, they're going to steal the root, and then now Moon Meander in trouble. He missed the split earth though. You know,
What? That is complete BIM. That has to be a taunt, right? Like he just stops right in front of him.
He's the never ever king, man. I mean, he's the time king after all. But no, I God, that was, it's almost like he act like he thought he got stunned right there.
Yeah, he just stopped with an AFK or something. Like, that has to be a taunt, man. Like,
yeah, it looked a little funny.
He realized that I missed, but yeah. So, like, already though, there's a
yeah. Speaking of standing there, he basically stood right there. You're figuring that, okay, he's actually dead, so no point. But yeah, Split Earth, it's a difficult ability to land unless you have a setup, and they definitely do with Disruptor, but obviously right there, kind of missed timing and unfortunately missing as a result. So top lane, though, they're going to go for it. Slaughter, Mason jumps in. Slark, excuse me. Pounce is going to leash him out. Reports coming in. And now Demons take a lot of tower damage. No Shockwave ready, though, for Magnus. And
disrupted himself.
Did he actually almost die?
Yeah, good, wow. He would have died to the tower, but he's got disruption off, so all right play. But already, though, like, you can just kind of, you compare the supports now from DC and Team Onyx, obviously. Like, Misery has sort of been helping bot mid, obviously they've got a kill, whereas the two supports from SD and Leshrac have kind of done nothing, really. They tried a failed gank on the Magnus, but he's still farming very, very well, close to level 4. And obviously, you kind of compare that to the Clockwork, who's really been only against a dual lane, whereas Magnus being against a tri-lane, and obviously it's kind of night and day in that respect.
Troll Warlord. We got Troll Warlord down here. Well, now, I don't know how much insight you have on a Troll Warlord being a pretty unique hero, but what maybe should we expect to see with an item build here?
Yeah, I think, honestly, because he's just an agility carry, we're going to sort of see very similar to kind of most of what the carries are doing nowadays. Obviously, he will still go into Helmet Dominator. Probably pick up an SMY compared to a Manta, but just because of the extra sort of movement speed that he can get from it. But yeah, just something regular, like, you know, Helmet Dominator into SMY into BKB. Nothing too out of the ordinary, but Resolution has done some strange builds before, so we could be surprised. But there's smoke on mid. From both,
yeah,
actually.
Both sides.
Well,
I was going to say, and actually Flea, though, as soon as his supports leave, they open. Oh, the timing could not have been worse. Very, very ain't going to save him. Now here comes the two supports in Dubu as well as Demon. They will trap Wii on that quap. There we go with the Splitter's landing. Diabolic Edict, but there's too much nearby. And Wii is going to survive through despite that Soulcatcher debuff. The uphill attack's also missing quite a bit. So he just blinks away. He will survive in the end. And obviously working out pretty well once again for DC as even another counter ward comes out on top of that.
Illusion. I think Onyx are getting a little bit unlucky, honestly, with the rotations with SD and Leshrac, and I think they're going to be spotted out as well. The Courier spotted him. The Courier might go down, though.
Yeah. No, nothing on it anyways, but yeah, it sucks to lose that earlier on. However, Disruption used on Coddle, and now they're looking for a turn, though. Demon realizing he's in a bad spot. Troll World are going to chase him down. Out come the Axes, and Demon trying to walk through. Disruption not going to be ready. Stun comes out. Final object. Nice Clockwork block, though, with the cogs, and the Sunstrike. Resolution will fall right there as a turn kill happens, and Shadow Demon actually lives in the end. So hey, let's just say he planned that all along.
Yeah, that was a really good play from the Clockwork there, actually manning up against the Troll Warden, and obviously nice Sunstrike coming out from Flea as well. And it's a massive kill, honestly. Killing on the safe lane carry 5 minutes in is a massive boost. It's going to be giving Clockwork level 6 soon as well. And then he can help up rotations and try and help the other lane as well if they're struggling.
Especially when it feels like there wasn't any threat of him dying early on. That just happened to be a coincidence in terms of the rotations and everything. So works out very well. Nice shrine use right here between Demon and Love Yourself. And allow them to go back into the lanes and continue to do their thing. So Troll Warlord's farm overall is still very good, of course, but that obviously is slowing him down ever so slightly. Slark also having the free farm up here at the top lane. Dyer's bottom tower. Keep an eye on that. How that continues to go, but expecting probably the early Shadow Blade, I think that's usually a safe assumption on a hero like Slark.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, we look at the network already, and like, Moon is actually more farm than Resolution at the moment, which is just absurd, really. But he's got this 3-point or max in power build, which is, you know, working out really well for him. He is level 6 now as well, so he has RP available. I don't expect him to rotate, but perhaps we might see the supports rotating. Or talk about the supports, SD probably going down here.
Clockwork again, gonna try to save him though. Sets up the Sunstrike with the Cox. Three heroes there, so spreading that damage out. But Shadow Demon again barely surviving. We in the back are looking to finish him off. Will do so. And now Clockwork actually in trouble himself. Most likely gonna be taken out as well. The Mana Leak stun, and yes, there will be a kill out of him. So that Clockwork Sunstrike combo is actually pretty damn strong, but that time around, unfortunately, too many targets and not able to get much out of it there.
Here comes Colt as well. Colt has rotated over to try and stop the pressure onto the tier 1, but it should be fine. Like I said, RP is available from Moon, but he's got this max in power build, so he looks like he's just looking to farm as much as possible. It looks like he's going Helm of Dom as well, actually, which is really interesting in itself. But you know, it's been a kind of a flavor of the month, this item, on every kind of role, yeah. Every kind of hero, and he's got it himself. So he's got good farm. He's the second top net worth, actually. So like, he's kind of like the carry as well. Like, so why not? It's good attack speed.
It feels like, yeah, not only one, but even two Dominators we see sometimes. I mean, people love this item. It is no doubt the most popular kind of core item, I think it's safe to say. Right now on the scene, so.
And you did mention it in the draft as well, how like Moon likes this kind of more battle style of build, or more kind of, yeah, you know, a fighting style. And Helm of Dom is just great, gives him good early stats, and attack speed, everything that a Magnus looking to do damage would want for. But he's got RP, Coral is around as well. Maybe traps can kill the Slark if they get a full Illuminate Blast, perhaps. But.
Gonna come up there, doing some good damage, but well, they found the jump is the question. Doesn't look like they're gonna be sneaky about it. They'll just pop out, and obviously the regen kicking in for Mason. So no kill just yet. Bottom lane, though. Rotation coming in. Resolution. They are going to be smoked up and charging on in. Mason, by the time he realizes, he's in trouble. Now comes the open on Resolution. The Sunstrike follow-up, and down he goes. So, yeah, he's really couldn't do anything about that. That was a good smoke gank coming out from Onyx. However, Flea's in trouble himself. They put down a sentry just in case. The Ghost Walk not going to happen anyways, and he will fall in the end, so they end up taking him out anyways in the middle lane.
Mm-hmm. It looks like they, I don't think, yeah, Onyx can't try and pressure Radiant's this two on tower. There's a TP from Cotwall already, so that's definitely going to stop any kind of pressure. Letrak's going to try and get some damage with the Diabolic Elite, but takes a lot of damage from that Illuminate, actually. And Misery is coming over. They might be able to try and secure a kill.
Mana Leak's done, happens. You see the Ignite is up, and Resolution's like, I gotcha! He's going to chase him down and get the Axe thrown out, and successfully gets that kill as a result. More coming through. Shadow Demon dodging initially, but puts onto the Coddle right there. That's just going to delay the inevitable, and he will fall too. So a couple more kills for DC and Resolution. That farm starting to build back up now. Top three of the four farmers in this game all belonging on the side of DC. You mentioned Moomiander especially second in the game right now.
Yeah. Net worth. That's crazy. Yeah, but I think the biggest reason why this is going so well, though, is that the one weakness of Magnus kind of juggling from the start is that obviously it allows the supports in the safe lane from Onyx to kind of rotate. But I think Misery's played a great game here. He's kind of spotted out the rotations from both the SD and Leshrac, particularly kind of helping the Quap. And it's kind of acted as the bodyguard. Here comes the Quap bot lane talking to Misery.
Yeah, Cog's going to block him again, but the Sunstrike this time a little bit late. Falls the Split Earth, actually. Now they're turning on a Clockwork. Shadow Demon puts them under, though. And a delay right here, and the Illuminate goes through, but Love Yourself will survive. So, unfortunately, the timing of both the Sunstrike and the Split Earth missing that time around. There's a lot of communication involved with these cogs going up, but unable to connect right there. So Ogre lives, and DC will kind of reset some things. But then there's also Quap, again, who happens to be the top farm of the game. She has a Yul Scepter right click right here as far as queued up, which she's trying to get for next. But may need to be a little bit careful as they are rotating mid. But yeah, she's slippery, so pretty difficult hero to kill here.
Yeah, I don't know if they have the damage into one Split Earth, actually. They might need a Clockwork ult as well, but there is a smoke coming out from DC as well. It's going to get popped, actually, but he's got haste. Should be enough, but there's TP coming in from Clockwork.
Yeah, Clockwork with that hook shot. Can he let? Oh, yeah, it doesn't have it, actually. 15 second cooldown, so not going to be able to assist.
Dire's top tower is smoke's under popped attack. There, but. As a result, Moon's going to take a tower by himself, actually.
Yeah.
I think Slark's very kind of worried, like, because if Moomiander gets one plus one from the Ogre or the Quap, they're going to be able to kill the Slark. So they're going to give up both towers, actually, both mid and top. So giving away a lot of map control right now. Not getting much trade, although bot lane.
Yeah, they catch him right here. Resolution again, going to try to make his way out, and actually gets the cog killed immediately to start running away, but Disruption comes out as well from Shadow Demon, and that will be enough to secure the kill. So a little bit scary right there in terms of chasing him down, but the news has come through. But then turn kill onto Leshrac actually happening. The Sonic Wave use from Wii. Let me know if that was absolutely necessary, but better to guarantee the kill than to not, I guess. Demon also going to be chased down, Fire Blast onto him, and a double kill for Quap in the end. And they will finish the job that their Troll Warlord started right here as they did take out the bottom tower. So, yeah, the two tower kills. I mean, Magnus especially getting to the top tower, being the first tower kill of the game. Did not expect that, but Moomiander, he's having a hell of a game. I guess Magnus is becoming one of his more go-to heroes.
Yeah, I think it just goes that he was kind of, he just had free farm in the jungle, and the sports didn't really do anything about it. They tried the one gank over here, which obviously failed because of the splitter missed, and when you kind of miss these Dyer's kind of crucial ganks with it, like an SD plus his partner, it's just bad news, honestly. Like, the whole point of SD being picked here is so they can kind of combo it with this Leshrac. If you think about it, there's no Luna, there's no good Lelouchian, you know, carry, there's no Terrorblade. So the reason, you know, this SD has to get a lot of advantage in the early game with these ganks, that there's no, you know, agility carry that they can kind of use for the illusion slot isn't the greatest kind of illusion kind of carry, so these early ganks not paying off is really hurting T-Monix.
Yeah, I agree there, and you know, I knew DC would be ahead, but man, I was not expecting the graph to look like this. 10,000 net worth lead at 12 and a half minutes. That is pretty absurd, nearly a 5,000 experience lead as well. I mean, obviously you got the top three farmers all belonging on their side, so maybe a little more understandable, but you're going to have a Blink Dagger now very shortly on Magnus. He has yet to go an RPO because he really hasn't had the opportunity, but obviously a Blink Dagger going to change that, as you would figure, and Helltroll Warlord, the Dragonlance going to be worked on next, and more tower pushes to come, I'm sure. Speaking of Wii, he's going to chase down Clockwork right here. Silence comes out with that Orchid that he just got already, and he gets the kill on a Clockwork. That's an insanely fast Orchid, man.
It's something that we don't see a lot of co-ops do. Normally they look towards the, you know, the Ags or the Blade Mail or even the Veil, but I think because he's had such a good time in the mid lane with Ogre sort of sitting him, this early Orchid can pay complete dividends, particularly against Slark. If you can catch him before the Dark Pact, then they can easily kill him, and he's going to be using it here against the Leshrac as well. Most likely going to kill him. He's going to blink out. It's going to be fine.
Love it. The mobility is just pretty absurd, and nothing that Onyx can seems that they can do against it. I mean, that's just simply the look at the Troll Warlord top lane. The Bloodlust, you got the Battle Trance popped, and he's just swinging away at that tower. So that tower going to drop pretty quickly. Shrineus, meanwhile, over here, Silence coming out on a Clockwork. Trying to chase him down, though, so we force to blink away. The team support is nearby, though. Centaur's stun. Meanwhile, is that a Helm of the Dominator? Is that just simply, yeah, it is a Helm of the Dominator. That might have been a neutral creep for a second. It's doing its thing, but no. Somebody's controlling that and going to box them out. And nobody dying after all of that, but they did get the secondary tower at the top lane. So this doesn't necessarily scream massive tower push, although I guess Troll Warlord kind of is that hero at the same time. You know, Battle Trance allows for that.
It's just that DC had such a great advantage in the laning phase that they can kind of push the advantage and take towers. I think Roche probably is going to be on the next agenda. Clockwork does, you know, kind of scout out with the flare, but even if Onyx know that DC are taking Roche, it's not going to be anything they can really do about it.
Yeah.
There's still towers up as well. They might try and take the towers, then take Shrine, then take Roshan, and kind of look towards ending the game, because with this kind of advantage in the laning phase, it's only looking really one way, unless Onyx can do something crazy.
Not often 14 minutes into the game, we're already talking about them trying to end it now, but DC just really has this absurd lead here at this point. 11 hero kills, but that only tells very, very mini part of the story. Nearly 15,000. Yeah, that was... didn't even mean to do that. Dragonlance has been finished on Troll World. It looks like Shadowblade going to be coming out next, so he's going to even have more amp damage from that as well. Some nice extra mobility, and they take out Roshan. Is that a Troll Warlord? No, Quap actually picks it up. The Aegis here. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah, it just allows Quap to jump in and kind of set everything in motion. Obviously, not only that, it kind of allows them to have two kind of sieges. Like, obviously, with Troll Warlord should be safe, obviously. He's got the Dragon Lance, so he's got enough range to sort of be able to sort of hit the tower without being too committed. Whereas, obviously, Quap has the Aegis, so you know, two both should be kind of safe when sieging the high ground.
Yeah.
But it looks like Onyx are still going to push him down bot. I don't think DC should allow this to happen. To try and set up, they're going to smoke, perhaps trying to set up, or they're going to run down there. I don't think Onyx are going to be able to push this tower in time.
Yeah, the last thing you want to do as a team that's really far ahead is just kind of trade towers, honestly. It's because that just let them build back into the game. So, yeah, DC is going to make a point to defend down here, it seems like. Flea, he has his Hand of the Midas finished, although it's not Radiant's actually on him. But again, you look at his item compared to the side of the Radiant here. And yeah, Shadow Demon's going to be found. Flea's like, all right, well, I'm out of here. Kind of using his teammate as bait, but that's understandable at that point. He has 16 minutes in. This game's just getting out of hand. The comeback potential for Team Onyx feels so small right now. I mean, Sark chose to go with the Echo Saber first, a little more farm potential, and now Shadowblade is almost finished on him. I guess that could potentially be something, but it's going to need a lot of things to happen in their favor.
Yeah, there's an invisible Queen of Pain here as well. Probably going to kill this Leshrac if he spots him. Yeah, there we go.
Leshrac silenced the whole time. Has to watch himself die. Yeah, the early Orchid's fun to see. This, as you pointed out, this is not an item we actually see too often, but because of this lead, I mean, he's like, might as well, and it's working.
Yeah, exactly.
Time.
I think if he was struggling a lot more, we might see some a bit more standard or more a little bit more orthodox in terms of, say, like a Veil or straight blade melee into Ag or something like that. But with Orchid, it just allows them to get those solid pickoffs as we just saw there. So.
Warlord, battle trance pop. Look at Flea! Oh my god, Disruption puts him under, but it ain't gonna matter. No buyback at this point. Soxa actually even credit for the kill right there with the Illuminate. And Leshrac's back up, and guess what? Orchid, your best friend, is back. Gonna chase him down. Not enough for the kill though. Dupe were able to make it out. Diabolic getting popped. And now look at the turn on a Quinnipan. Quinnipan in trouble, but the RP from Mumiander saves the day and looks to turn on a Clockwork right there. Some way, somehow, Quap actually survived because of that RP from the Magnus there. And Queen's even going back in. Obviously, he has the Aegis, so he doesn't really care too much. But yeah, look at that. GG at 17 and a half minutes. They could have GG'd at 12 minutes, and we wouldn't have been surprised.
I think, honestly, that this game just goes back to the SD and the Leshrac not being able to do as much. Like, the whole point, particularly in these kind of, you know, very important high-tier games, is that the supports are there to sort of dictate the tempo of the game. And when you have, like, an SD Leshrac, both supports that are very focused on the early game and sort of setting up ganks, if they aren't able to do that, particularly when DC are running very greedy style of lineup with, say, Moomian or with his Iron Talon, if you don't find kills with Team Onyx, the game is practically already over.
Yeah.
It's kind of very risky to play like an SD Leshrac, particularly when you don't have that backup support of like an SD Luna to sort of carry in the mid game. But in the end, good play from DC. Just again, solid play. Misery had his early game rotations on point, knew exactly where, you know, Leshrac and the SD were going to be, and Misery was there as the bodyguard to protect Wii, especially. And yeah, not much to say other than that, really.
It's a little unfortunate in the sense that I was looking forward to seeing the Troll Warlord like kind of advance and like through like a longer game, see how he does. But I mean, they just rolled. I feel like that resolution could have been any hero at that point.
Yeah,
though, and they still would have been fine.
Yeah, the same way.
So in the end, though, the Troll Warlord pick, kind of a unique stuff there. Again, the first time it's been picked up this tournament. Obviously, a victory in the end, and they're feeling pretty good right now. You can tell they are clicking on all cylinders, and it's going to be tough for Team Onyx to defeat the tournament favorites here in Digital Chaos. So, well, we're going to go to a short break here, guys. So a quick game number one, but stay tuned. We got game number two. We'll see if Team Onyx at least puts up a better performance here and perhaps trying to split the series. But DC, they are looking good. So stay tuned, guys. I'm Breaky CPK, joined by Mini here. We'll be right back with game number two.